We'll be right back. Toros.
Toros.
Y mi prieta chula torito me está mirando. Toro, toro, toro. Toro, relajo. Ya te estoy quitando, torito, lo alegre estado. Ya te estoy quitando, torito, lo alegre estado.
Ay, ay.
Te va a aplaudir y con bravura vas a morir.
Puro Internacional de América, sí, señores.
Toro, toro.
Jalisco, sí señor. ¡Ay, ay, ay!
Thank you.
mundo canta cuando suena el mariachi.
Cuando el mariachi suena,
el mundo canta cuando suena el mariachi. ¡Viva el mariachi!
What a wonderful performance. Thank you very much. My name is Dr. Jeremiah Chakaya. I'm the president of the union. And it's now my pleasure to introduce to you Pablo Lemas, the mayor of Zapopan, which is the municipality where this beautiful venue is located. Pablo Lemas, please.
Muy buenas tardes. Me da mucho gusto darles la más cordial bienvenida a este municipio de Zapopan. Saludo con todo gusto al doctor Jeremiah Chacawa, quien nos acompaña el día de hoy como presidente de la Unión Internacional contra la Tuberculosis y Enfermedades Respiratorias. A todas las distinguidas personalidades del Presidium, a todos los médicos que nos acompañan esta tarde. Aunque ustedes no lo crean, sobre todo para nuestros visitantes internacionales, el escuchar a nuestras tradiciones mexicanas, el escuchar a nuestro mariachi, al ver a estos extraordinarios bailarines mexicanos, nos sigue llenando de esa gran emoción. Como decimos en México, la piel se nos sigue poniendo chinita después de escuchar a estos grandes músicos. Por supuesto, les damos la más cordial bienvenida al municipio de Zapopan y al estado de Jalisco, tierra del mariachi, del tequila y de las tradiciones de nuestro México, pero también un estado que se desarrolla y que innova todo el tiempo. El día de hoy les damos la más cordial bienvenida porque no solamente tenemos a médicos especialistas, tenemos a lo más importante de la innovación a nivel internacional, sino porque también para nosotros es un factor fundamental el tenerles aquí. Y me refiero porque en México tenemos un problema muy importante, del cual por supuesto este municipio de Zapopan no está exento. Y ese grave problema que vive nuestro país se llama desigualdad. Es decir, nuestro país y nuestro municipio se encuentran ya como país en las principales economías del orbe. Nuestro municipio es el motor de la economía en Jalisco. Sin embargo, tenemos muchas personas que se están quedando exentas de este desarrollo económico. Y en mucho se debe a que no hemos tenido la posibilidad de darles mejores condiciones de desarrollo. Y esto tiene que ver, por supuesto, con condiciones de oportunidades de trabajo, pero también con oportunidades de tener mejores condiciones de salud. Por eso festejamos el que el día de hoy estos trabajos se celebren en nuestro municipio, porque contribuirán a ello, a lo que se ha propuesto esta administración, que es luchar contra la desigualdad. Ustedes, durante los días que estarán en este gran evento, en esta gran conferencia, disfrutarán de gran comida, de grandes espectáculos, pero sobre todo se llevarán en sus corazones el cariño de todos los mexicanos. Si algo sabemos hacer en Jalisco, si algo sabemos hacer en Zapopan, es demostrar nuestro cariño, demostrar que lo recibimos con los brazos abiertos y que seguramente esto motivará a que ustedes regresen a nuestra ciudad. Enhorabuena y que sus trabajos sean en beneficio no solamente de la medicina y de los avances en la tecnología, sino sobre todo que sean en beneficio de toda la humanidad. Muchísimas gracias.
Buenas noches, señoras y señores, Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I will speak in Spanish the first a few words. Agradecemos al licenciado Jesús Pablo Lemus Namarro la cordial bienvenida que nos ha dado hoy aquí. Y también al gobierno de México y en especial a la ciudad de Guadalajara, esa ciudad que legendaria, cuna esclarecida de la cultura mexicana que Jorge Negrete inmortalizó en la canción insignia de este estado, llamándola la perla más linda de todo Jalisco es mi Guadalajara. Estamos muy orgullosos de estar aquí en esta ciudad para compartir con vosotros estos 4 días de ciencia, con colaboración entre colegas que trabajamos en el área de la salud de la tuberculosis y también el compromiso que tenemos con los gobiernos, con la sociedad civil, con las pacientes y las personas afectadas por las enfermedades que, en las que trabajamos. Los ojos del mundo estarán fijos sobre Guadalajara durante 4 días. Esta es la conferencia más importante de la tuberculosis y es un gran honor de estar aquí en México y en especial en esta ciudad de Guadalajara. Delegates, colleagues, it is my pleasure to welcome you to the 48th Union World Conference on Lung Health. My sincere thanks to the government of Mexico, the city of Guadalajara, and our local partners that have worked with us to make possible this conference in Mexico, and to make it possible to bring together scientists from over 120 countries who are joined together in the fight against tuberculosis. As the G20 countries assume greater leadership for tackling drug-resistant tuberculosis and to funding TB research, Mexico has to play an important role, a leadership role in this effort. And I hope that this year's conference in Guadalajara will have a larger role for Mexico in the fight against TB. This year's Union Conference convenes during one of the most critical moments in the global fight against tuberculosis. Last year, the World Health Organization announced that TB is now the world's leading cause of death, the leading infectious killer in the world. And also, the review and antimicrobial resistance commissioned by the UK government projected by 2050, we could see as many as 2.5 million deaths annually from drug-resistant tuberculosis. The status quo is unacceptable. And so our theme this year is accelerating towards elimination. And my hope is that this conference will galvanize the community in a way that no other conference before, and to move from incremental steps to taking giant leaps towards the global goal to end the TB epidemic. It requires that we move faster on progress on multiple fronts, on TB and its comorbidities of HIV and diabetes, on childhood TB, and on reducing poverty. It means that we must fight back harder against the influence of the tobacco industry, an industry that just a few weeks ago announced that it's going to spend $1 billion in advocacy over the next few years. It's going to require us to make leaps and reducing pollution that poisons the air that we breathe. This is our urgent duty, and we all share it. Luckily, this year, the conference is also taking place in a moment of enormous opportunity. As we will see presented here this week, scientific research is producing numerous innovations that we can harness to accelerate progress. At the same time, we must make the most of the political opportunities ahead. Next month, the World Health Organization and the government of the Russian Federation are convening the first global ministerial conference on ending tuberculosis in the sustainable development era. And next year, the United Nations will host the first ever high-level meeting on tuberculosis. These are extraordinary opportunities for the global TB community, and I am confident that we will seize them to mobilize an unprecedented support for ending the tuberculosis epidemic. The clock is ticking. We have an urgent duty, and we must fulfill together. It is up to us. For our part, the Union is forging new partnerships through which we are pursuing innovation and global TB response. As we all know, the Global Fund has had a huge impact in the fight against tuberculosis, HIV/AIDS, and malaria. The Global Fund has been a very strong financing partner of the Union. For example, in India, where the Global Fund supports the Union, with Global Fund support, the Union has been working with thousands of affected communities, applying innovative approaches to helping people at risk for tuberculosis access, screening, and diagnosis, and linking patients to community-based care. And so it is my pleasure to announce a new partnership between the Union and the Global Fund. To join me in making this announcement, I would like to welcome Director Dr. Christoph Benn, Director of Global External Relations and Partnerships at the Global Fund, to join me here at the stage. Christoph.
Thank you so much, José Luis, for inviting me to share the stage with you tonight to announce our really great new partnership. It's a great honor and privilege for us from the Global Fund. As you said, we are at a very critical moment in the fight against tuberculosis. So much has been achieved, but if we really want to reach the historical goal of ending TB as an epidemic and leaving no one behind, then we need to dramatically accelerate our efforts, and that's what I believe the whole conference is about. And for this acceleration, I think we need three important elements. One is political commitment, and you've already mentioned the upcoming important international meetings that will see the demonstration and expression of this political commitment. Secondly, science and innovation, and we will have very important discussions here at this conference about progress in science and innovation. But thirdly, we also need the finances, the resources, so that all the programs against tuberculosis can be implemented around the world. And that's what our new partnership will be about. The Union and the Global Fund have been working together very closely for many years, but now I believe we will bring it to a new level. And I think there could be no better partners for this than the Union, that represents the best in the world in terms of scientific and technical expertise, and the Global Fund to fight AIDS, tuberculosis, and malaria, which is the largest fund of its kind, mobilizing and dispersing around $4 billion per year, and providing about 65% of the international funding against tuberculosis. But we also know that all these resources so far are falling short of covering the full gap that we need to cover so that every person in the world has access to diagnosis, treatment, and care, and we will also manage to find the missing cases that we have not been able to find so far. So we will partner together, bringing together our expertise and knowledge and networks to mobilize particularly additional resources from the private sector, from high net worth individuals, and also initiating some innovative finance mechanisms together, such as blended finance, combining loans and grants to finance large-scale programs in different countries. So from the Global Fund, we are extremely excited and proud that we can partner with you, and I think together we can achieve great things and indeed move the world closer to this noble goal of ending TB as an epidemic. Thank you so much.
So, It gives me now great pleasure to introduce the next speaker, Mileni Romero, who is an odontologist and has worked at the Center for Care of Patients with Infectious Diseases nationally, including community work in the military hospital of Caracas to political prisoners. And yet, it is her personal story from earlier this year that she has come here today to share with all of us, her story as a TB patient. Please join me in welcoming Mileni to the stage.
Primero que nada, muy buenas noches. Doy las gracias a la organización de la Unión por haberme dado el gran honor de estar aquí esta noche con todos ustedes, compartiendo mi historia y los padecimientos de todos los pacientes. Soy venezolana, de 31 años de edad, odontóloga. Durante mi último año en la Universidad Central de Venezuela, tuve la gran oportunidad de atender a pacientes en un centro de atención a pacientes con enfermedades infectocontagiosas, el único centro a nivel nacional de mi país. Ahí tuve la oportunidad de atender a pacientes con tuberculosis, VIH, hepatitis, sífilis, gonorrea, en fin, cualquier cantidad de enfermedades que pudieran siquiera imaginar. Posteriormente, tuve la oportunidad de atender pacientes en el Hospital Militar de Caracas y era la única de mis compañeros que podía atender a presos políticos en este momento tan difícil que está pasando mi país. Cuando yo los atendía, era sencillamente un cubículo de cuatro paredes en donde yo me encontraba alrededor de tres militares, uno a mi lado derecho, uno a mi lado izquierdo y el otro militar en la puerta, para ellos verificar que yo no tuviera ningún contacto, aparte del paciente operador, con el preso político que yo estaba atendiendo. Aunado a esto, los militares tenían sus rifles para cualquier cosa que pudiera pasar. Me preguntaban nombre, mi identificación, tipo de sangre, dirección, con quién vivía, en fin, toda la cantidad de datos que ellos podían recolectar de mi persona. Y luego, cuando el paciente regresaba a ese hospital, yo era la única que podía atenderlo. Posteriormente, hice mi servicio comunitario en un sitio de muy bajos recursos con niños. Me di cuenta que la realidad de mi país es que hay escasez en todo sentido. Y más aún, me di cuenta cuando en febrero de este año, 2017, comienzo a padecer muchos dolores en la espalda, comencé a caminar de costado, dificultad para respirar. Después de múltiples consultas médicas, a las cuales ningún médico lograba hallar mi diagnóstico certero, yo sabía que había algo en mí que no estaba bien. Que lo que ellos me decían que yo tenía era incorrecto, eso no era. Así que insistí, luego de semanas con dolor y con todos los síntomas que puede sufrir un paciente con tuberculosis, conseguí a mi héroe, a un excelente doctor en la capital de Venezuela, y él se dio cuenta que yo tenía 500 mililitros de líquido pleural en mi pulmón derecho. Luego de eso, se enviaron muestras En Venezuela hay muy pocos sitios en donde se hacen esas muestras para dar los resultados y hay que esperar mucho tiempo para que den un resultado positivo o negativo. Total que supe que lo tenía, tuve tuberculosis extrapulmonar. Para mi fortuna, gracias a Dios, pero eso no era todo. Luego de meses de tratamiento, fui presentando continuamente muchos efectos secundarios. Muchos que me llevaron a tener que posponer mi tratamiento durante varias semanas. Fue tan fuerte que tuve que ir a un médico en vista de que no se conseguían medicinas para los efectos secundarios, no se consigue medicina para problemas gástricos, no se consigue medicina para problemas dermatológicos. Así que me dirigí a otro doctor, un especialista, y él me dio dos opciones. Él me dijo, bueno, Mileni, puedes hacer dos cosas. Uno, paras el tratamiento de la tuberculosis y tú vas a mejorar, te vas a sentir mejor, vas a poder atender tus pacientes, pero en algún momento te vas a morir, muy pronto. O sigues padeciendo lo que padeces físicamente, como te ves en el espejo todos los días, cómo te sientes, pero vas a vivir. Así que yo elegí la segunda opción. Yo simplemente quiero pedirles a ustedes que, así como yo soy profesional de la salud y atiendo pacientes, les pido que por favor se pongan de nuestro lado. Un día podemos ser doctores y al día siguiente podemos ser pacientes. Solamente les pido nos escuchen. El principal derecho humano de toda la humanidad, valga la redundancia, el derecho a vivir. Eso es lo único que yo les pido. Así que me encuentro aquí con nuestra sociedad civil, colegas de las comunidades afectadas de la región y de alrededor del mundo, con un llamado urgente para quienes se encuentren en este recinto y para nuestros gobernantes al regresar a sus casas. Es una respetuosa invitación a trabajar de forma colaborativa con todos nosotros a fin de lograr aumentar el financiamiento para las actividades de los programas de tuberculosis con el fin de lograr las metas nacionales en cada país de Latinoamérica. Garantizar acceso ininterrumpido a herramientas diagnósticas, incluyendo expert, baciloscopías, cultivos, pruebas de farmacosensibilidad, tanto de primera como de segunda línea. Trabajar con las agencias reguladoras y los legisladores para establecer políticas que promuevan acceso constante a insumos y medicamentos de calidad asegurada de primera y segunda línea, incluyendo las formulaciones pediátricas y que permitan el acceso tanto a los nuevos medicamentos como a los regímenes alternativos. Garantizar la protección de las personas afectadas por tuberculosis para su subsistencia mediante vivienda, empleo, horarios accesibles de clínicas comunitarias y programas basados en comunidad para asegurar el éxito completo de su tratamiento. Brindar prioridades programáticas a las poblaciones vulnerables, incluyendo usuarios de drogas y personas privadas de libertad, para garantizar diagnóstico oportuno y cuidado comprensivo no estigmatizante basado en derechos. Involucrar significativamente a las comunidades afectadas, y miembros de la sociedad civil en todos los niveles programáticos, tanto en los planes operativos de implementación como en la investigación. Esto sencillamente es una petición de parte de todos nosotros para que se solidaricen, porque todos sentimos, todos padecemos. Y yo hago una simple pregunta y voy a pedir que por favor levante la mano con unas preguntas que voy a hacer. ¿Quiénes de aquí tienen hijos? Ok. ¿Quiénes de aquí tienen hermanos o hermanas? ¿Quiénes de aquí tienen tíos o tías? ¿Sobrinos o sobrinas? ¿Padres? Solo les pedimos eso que ustedes, cada uno de ustedes, sienten por sus familiares. Quieren que vivan. Nosotros también queremos vivir. Y creo que todos lo merecemos. Muchas gracias.
Muchísimas gracias, Mileni, los miembros de la sociedad civil y pacientes que estuvieron aquí con nosotros. We are now, I would like to introduce now to, Dr. Jerry Eichmann, who is the director of PAHO Mexico.
Distinguished delegates, members of the scientific community, civil society, colleagues from public health, ladies and gentlemen, friends, a very good night to all of you. It is a great honor to present here tonight the Director General of the World Health Organization, Dr. Tedros, and the Director of the Pan American Health Organization, Dr. Carissa Etienne. Please receive their warmest greetings from both of them. I thank and congratulate Mr. José Luis Castro, Executive Director of the Union, the Government of Mexico, represented here by my friend Pablo Curi, the Government of the State of Jalisco, for bringing us together and for the organization of this event on one of the most important global public health topics. I would like to take a moment to extend our heartfelt condolences for the loss of life caused by the earthquakes of the 7th and the 19th of September in Mexico. That we are here tonight speaks of the great resilience that characterizes the Mexican people. I also want to remember the suffering and the destruction caused by the wave that didn't seem to end of hurricanes in the Caribbean. This morning, I spoke with the director of PAHO, Dr. Etienne, who recently visited Dominica, and she told me that the destruction and the despair she witnessed goes beyond any imagination. Our thoughts are with all of you, and PAHO and WHO stands in solidarity and offers support to the countries and people affected. Without any doubt, the 21st century has presented us with very important challenges. Thank you.
Ah.
Want me to start again?
So,
no, okay. Sorry. The world, in terms of health, has changed since the start of the current millennium. And despite the obvious particularities and differences between our countries, it's clear that all countries face similar battles. In this first 17 years of the 21st century, we've witnessed the surge of new pathogens, SARS, H5N1, H7N9, and MERS. And we have also seen diseases reemerge, like Ebola, yellow fever, and Zika. In these 17 years, wealth and economic growth permitted millions of people to wage out of poverty in many countries. But in many others, the growth has been very painful and unequal, when wealth has been distributed only among a few privileged. Yes, the indicators of extreme poverty have improved since 1990, but today, one in five persons in the world still live on less than $1.25 per day, and some 800 million people suffer hunger, many of them children. In only 17 years, we've seen an increasing number of first and second line antibiotics fail. This translates in an increasing global public health threat, where common infections will start to become deadly again, and where the fight to eliminate diseases such as tuberculosis every day becomes more complicated. Also, in these 17 years, we have achieved that people live longer, but these gains have not necessarily translated in lives with better health. We have seen how the number of people living in cities has increased rapidly. Globalization and urbanization have changed our lifestyles, in many instances have made them less healthy. An increased number of people breathe contaminated air, have adopted a sedentary lifestyle, and do not have access to healthy food. All these factors have led to the increase of chronic diseases, which have replaced the infectious diseases as a main cause of death and years of healthy life lost. In some societies, it is even estimated that the next generation, our young people, for the first time in history, could have a shorter life expectancy than their parents if we do not change business as usual. However, this is also a historic moment for public health. Today, we see a unique commitment by countries all over the world towards health. I would like to share a few examples. In 2003, the first internationally binding public health treaty was approved in the World Health Organization. The Framework Convention on Tobacco Control became a reality. Then, in 2008, global health started to occupy a firm place on the agenda of heads of states, international affairs ministers, and the General Assembly of the United Nations. Extremely relevant topics such as chronic diseases, Ebola, and antimicrobial resistance have been discussed by world leaders in New York. Only in July of this year, for the first time, the topic of health was firmly placed on the G20 agenda. And still to come this year, we've already heard it, we're preparing for high-level meetings in Uruguay on chronic diseases and in Moscow, Russia, on TB. History does not end here. Next year, we will have a very important year for public health, with meetings in the UN General Assembly to review progress on the 2011 and 2014 summits on NCDs, and for the first time, very importantly, a high-level meeting dedicated solely to TB. And of course, one of the maximum expressions of this global commitment to health we can find in the adoption of the Sustainable Development Goals, the Agenda 2030, and in particular in its Goal 3, to guarantee a healthy life and to promote well-being for all at all ages. In 2015, we estimated that 400 million people did not have access to essential health services, that 40% of the world population was not covered by Social Security, and that millions of people in low and middle income countries fell under the poverty line due to out-of-pocket healthcare expenditure, healthcare cost. This is unacceptable. We're denying all those people a fundamental human right, and this scenario is an obvious risk for meeting our global goals like the one we are discussing now. And it is for this reason that the inclusion of universal health coverage and access to health services in the 2030 agenda was so important. Eventually, as Dr. Tedros, our new WHO director, recently pointed out, universal health is a political decision and an ethical principle. If countries decide to invest in advancing towards universal health, they will not only be planting the seed for a more equitable and fair future for its societies, but it will also be moving towards accomplishing other global goals of the 2030 agenda, such as ending poverty, improving gender equality, promoting decent work, and promoting economic growth, among others. And of course, these health services need to be people-centered, looking at the people, looking at the person, and not at the organ or only one disease. But at the same time, the SDGs recognize that the health sector cannot be alone in this fight. The health challenges of today need to be tackled in an intersectorial manner. For example, with access to sustainable energy sources, we can avoid 3 million premature deaths related to chronic pulmonary disease due to air pollution. Another example, stopping antimicrobial resistance, including the case of multi-drug resistance TB, requires a very strong support from the agriculture sector, from the private sector, with investments in research and development. And we will need justice and strong institutions to stand up against the very powerful interests of the tobacco industry. I want in this context to thank and congratulate the union on its important work it's carrying out as great partners of PAHO and WHO in the fight against tobacco. Without doubt, the SDG agenda is so ambitious that it seeks to transform this world, converting it in a fairer and more stable place in which we guarantee that nobody stays behind, that everybody can benefit from economic growth and development. The team that joins us here today is an integral part of this scenario. TB is now the leading infectious disease killer, and the underlying factors, the determinants of this disease, which contribute to the persistence of the high incidence of TB, still need to be addressed. Our challenge to accelerate towards elimination lies in how to address those underlying causes in an effective manner, integrated between various actors and within the current context of strengthening health systems and universal health. Within the framework of the NTB strategy and the various regional and global frameworks, innovative, interprogrammatic, and multisectoral initiatives have been developed. One of such initiatives is the control of TB in large cities, being implemented in 10 cities in the Americas, including in Tijuana and Mexico. However, the political momentum to end TB as it stands now is insufficient. Antimicrobial resistance needs to be halted and reverted. Sufficient and sustained financing is needed. Science, research, and innovation needs to be scaled up, and above all, multisectoral accountability is required with leadership at the very highest level. It's obvious, in the interconnected and multipolar world we live in, where health becomes more politicized, it's mandatory to form a common front, to advance one of our maximum aspirations, the enjoyment of the maximum achievable level of health for all. And it's within this context and within the context of this meeting that I want to invite you, ladies and gentlemen, to adopt and to embrace the 2030 agenda as your own. I want to invite us all to not commit the error to adopt only one part of the agenda. For example, that we present here would only look at the objective 3.3 that seeks to end the TB in 2030, or only at objective 3A, which seeks to strengthen the implementation of the Framework Convention on Tobacco. We need to embrace the entire 2030 agenda. We need to find the inherent alliances and synergies to meet our goals. And above all, we need to find in ourselves the will and the commitment to work every day with those goals in mind. That will be the only way for countries and for our societies to walk this new road towards a better life for all without leaving anybody behind. For the UN, for the World Health Organization, and for PAHO, it's essential and very encouraging to count with partners such as yourselves, sharing the same passion, the same values, a better world, a healthier world for all. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Jerry Ekman, and thank you very much for Mileni, who was here before and who told us a personal story, a story that moves many of us to do the things that we do, and the union to do what it does best. Ladies and gentlemen, this is a great week for us in the union. Thank you all for coming to our conference. Our conference is an important annual event in which we network, make new friends, establish relationships that we may have severed before, to be able to understand what is happening in our world of TB and chronic lung disease. It's my sincere hope that in the next few days, we will learn things, hear experiences of many people who are working in the field, in the trenches, to fight TB that has been a very stubborn disease to manage over many years. This is the time when we should be thinking about how to broaden our response to the TB epidemic, and I think this has been said very clearly and impressively by Dr. Jerry Ekman, who was here a few minutes ago. It's time to go beyond our TB clinics and really think through how we can broaden this response and make it truly a multisectoral approach. And I believe that in the next few days that we are here, that is exactly what we will be doing, to try and think through how we are going to broaden the TB response. It is also a time when we should make the noise that we need to make, and the civil society groups that are here will help us to do that, to make the noise that needs to be made, so that in fact policymakers can start listening, funders can contribute more to the fight against TB, and we can all achieve more in the area of tuberculosis and chronic lung disease. I think many things have already been said, and I don't want to extend your night because I know it's getting a little late. I would want now to introduce to you a special video that was prepared for us by, give me a minute, Honorable Dr. Taba, I don't know how to pronounce this, Honorable Dr. Taba Varghese, who is the President of Uruguay, in a film that is prepared specifically for us, to talk about the problem of chronic diseases. I think it's important for all of us to understand that even our TB that we've been fighting for many years is a chronic disease. It takes so long to treat it, and even after you've treated it, a proportion of our patients never quite get well. It is the beginning of chronic illness for them. So this film is extremely important for the union. Please welcome to view this special video that was made for the union conference. Thank you.
autoridades del Congreso, queridas colegas y queridos colegas, amigas y amigos, créanme que para mí es un honor saludarlos en oportunidad de la 48 Conferencia Mundial sobre Salud Pulmonar realizada en la ciudad de Guadalajara, en México. Y lo primero es lo primero, y lo primero es agradecerles por darme la oportunidad de expresar estas breves palabras ante todos ustedes. Como saben muy bien, dentro de las enfermedades pulmonares, agudas, crónicas, tumorales, degenerativas y las infecciosas, son las que más afectan profundamente a la salud mundial, dentro de otro cohorte de enfermedades crónicas. Y en el sector pulmonar, la EPOC, la fibrosis pulmonar y el cáncer de pulmón son relevantes. Y precisamente en este último, en el cáncer de pulmón, como ustedes saben muy bien, por supuesto, el flagelo del tabaco es eminente y relevante. En Uruguay hemos tomado con mucha preocupación y mucha seriedad la batalla contra el tabaquismo. Hemos hecho énfasis en una estrategia enfocada en la prevención y promoción de la salud, incrementando el precio de los productos de tabaco e implementando advertencias sanitarias en las cajillas de los cigarrillos que ocupan el 80% de ambas caras principales. De esta manera y con otras medidas, leyes, publicidad, etcétera, etcétera, se redujo la prevalencia de consumo de tabaco en jóvenes de un 22.8% a un 8.2% entre 2006 y 2014. No en vano, el Uruguay es el primer país de América en considerarse libre de humo de tabaco y el sexto en el mundo. Pero, es claro, aún queda mucho por hacer. A pesar de que no puedo estar físicamente con ustedes en el día de hoy, deseo enviarles a la distancia mi profundo agradecimiento por su presencia en este encuentro y que actividades como esta nos permiten avanzar en la búsqueda de soluciones globales para las enfermedades no transmisibles. Solamente unidos, muy fuerte, podremos vencer. Utilizando distintas herramientas, por ejemplo la prevención, la educación y la acción. Y esto es lo que tenemos que inculcar como médicos a nuestros colegas, a los estudiantes de medicina y también a los responsables de políticas públicas, a los políticos, a los gobiernos. Es momento que avancemos decididamente en la lucha por la salud. Y en ese sentido, un caso que no podemos perder de vista es el de las enfermedades pulmonares crónicas que integran el campo de las enfermedades no transmisibles y que nos deben ocupar muy especialmente por ser fundamentalmente previsibles y que diagnosticadas a tiempo pueden ser curadas. 3 de cada 4 personas mueren a causa de las enfermedades no transmisibles. Y el 34% de las muertes generadas por estas enfermedades son prematuras, es decir, se producen en personas de 30 a 69 años de edad. Qué importante es entonces que logremos mejorar estos indicadores con políticas públicas y privadas también, activas, responsables y socialmente comprometidas. Entre otras cosas, quería comunicarles, estimados colegas, que del 18 al 20 de octubre próximo realizaremos en Montevideo, Uruguay, en conjunto con la Organización Mundial de la Salud, la Conferencia Mundial sobre las Enfermedades No Transmisibles, copresidida además por los gobiernos de Finlandia, Rusia y Uruguay, un encuentro que será la antesala de la tercera reunión de alto nivel de la Asamblea General de las Naciones Unidas sobre este grupo de enfermedades previstas para septiembre del año próximo, así también como el desarrollo de un proceso intergubernamental sobre el documento final de esa reunión que tendrá lugar bajo los auspicios del presidente de la Asamblea General de dichas Naciones Unidas. Nuestro encuentro en Montevideo constituirá una gran oportunidad para renovar y fortalecer la lucha internacional contra estas enfermedades. Espero, sinceramente espero, y sería una alegría enorme contar con la participación y el aporte de todos ustedes. Por mi parte, me comprometo junto a todos ustedes a trabajar fuertemente para derrotar estas enfermedades. Muchas gracias por vuestra atención.
Buenas noches. Welcome. My name is Stacy Stender. I'm the chair of the Coordinating Committee of Scientific Activities. And I think I have some slides, I'm hoping. They're very few. I wanted to give you a bit of an overview of what we do as the CCSA and preparation for this conference and what we have in store for you in the next 3 days. Or not. There we go. Just a brief overview. This is a membership organization, the union, in addition to the institute, and I just wanted to share with you who all is involved with planning the conference. And I was reflecting as I was listening to the other speakers, my role, I became involved in the union when the conference occurred in Cape Town in 2008. I was sort of wrangled in. I live in Cape Town. And my mother and my maternal grandmother died of COPD, so I think I have affiliation with the adult and child lung health section. I work in HIV primarily. I used to smoke. My mother and my grandmother both smoked. I have a master's in infectious disease with an emphasis on molecular biology, and I'm a nurse. So I think other than zoonotic TB, I pretty much cover our subgroup, and then we also have a community advisory panel, which we had representatives on the stage during the speech there. We have a regional representative always with our conferences where we hold them, and then as well as representation from the institute. Next slide, please. Which I can't see anywhere, but okay. Just to give you all, you have access to the app. I hope most of you have downloaded the application. It's a very good way. Thanks. To be able to plan your next few days. Tomorrow we have the Road to the UN High Level meeting as start at 9 a.m. Friday we're looking at lived experience of the impact of the tobacco industry's corporate abuse of economically disenfranchised groups. And Saturday, we have a great plenary with Accelerating Lung Health Over the Life course. Next slide. Just a little background. This is over the years since 2008, if my vision is not that great, in terms of number of abstracts submitted. We have made great efforts, and we've achieved them in improving the science presented at the conference, so number of abstracts submitted as well as accepted. This year, there were 1,681 submissions, of which 857, so 50, a little over 50% were accepted. A big thank you, many of whom are in the audience. We had 502 peer reviewers to review the abstracts, so we have a minimum of 3 reviewers, so this has been a major achievement, and thank you all for your efforts. Some of the main interests, 200 submissions were for MDR-TB specifically. Tobacco control had the second largest number of submissions, as well as diagnostics, TB epidemiology. So, what you have in store for you, 19 oral abstract sessions, 18 short oral abstract sessions, and 57 poster sessions. This year we have more basic and clinical science than we ever have had in any conference, and I hope you all look at your app to see which sessions to attend. Final information point, we have two late breakers and one student session on Friday. There are going to be 7 presentations for the TB Union CDC late breaker, and then 6 presentations for the HIV TB present the session, and then 9 students will be presenting their research all on Friday. So, I would like to now take the opportunity to introduce our keynote speaker. Dr. Jeff Stark is an internationally recognized expert in the management of childhood tuberculosis and mycobacterial infections. He has served as the director of the Children's TB Clinic for almost 30 years and conducted and published research studies across the full spectrum of childhood tuberculosis. Globally, 170,000 children died in 2015 as a result of tuberculosis, which is nearly 500 children dying every day of a disease that is entirely curable, as we all know. The current public health approach to TB mostly focuses on adults, which has had a damaging impact on the outcomes for children living with TB. His talk today, entitled Childhood Tuberculosis at the Tipping Point, gives focus to the urgent challenge we face as a lung health community, that we must give much needed attention to the care and treatment of the young people who contract TB. It gives me great pleasure to welcome Dr. Jeffrey Stark to the stage.
Buenas noches, good evening. And if I try any more Spanish, this will turn into a comedy routine. First, I would like to thank the union and the organizers of the meeting for giving me this honor of representing the childhood tuberculosis community, whose members helped me prepare these remarks. I would also like to thank the translator, who's actually giving the talk to many of you. And most of all, I want to thank you for being here. 1 million annual cases of childhood tuberculosis, 210,000 deaths in children from tuberculosis, a treatable and preventable disease that is not being treated and is certainly not being prevented. Only about 1/3 of the cases are even recorded and reported. These are the current estimates from the World Health Organization, and some modeling studies have put the numbers even higher. WHO started issuing estimates of childhood tuberculosis cases and mortality only in 2011, 6 years ago, because there were inadequate methods to do so earlier. This current mortality rate of 21% is about the same as in the era before treatment was invented. Then there was nothing that could be done to help these afflicted children. Now, the main problem is that a large proportion of childhood TB cases are never correctly diagnosed, mistaken for pneumonia, complications of malnutrition, or bacterial meningitis. The modeling work of Peter Dodd and colleagues just published suggests that 96% of these tuberculosis deaths occur in children not receiving tuberculosis treatment. The deadliest forms of tuberculosis occur disproportionately in the youngest children. TB meningitis accounts for many of the deaths, and the brain damage it causes creates a staggering amount of morbidity in the survivors and a staggering economic burden for families and communities. Paradoxically, these vulnerable young children have been greatly underrepresented in tuberculosis research and public policy. Current modeling estimates are that tens to perhaps hundreds of millions of children, particularly in high-burden countries, already are infected with Mycobacterium tuberculosis. And although they may be free of disease now, they are the reservoir from which future TB cases will spring. My mentor, Catherine Sue, famously stated, "Primary tuberculosis in children is the fountainhead of tuberculosis disease. When acquired during childhood, it may develop into serious disease within a short time or remain latent during childhood only to emerge in adult life. It will be impossible to eliminate tuberculosis in children and adults unless this reservoir of childhood tuberculosis infection is finally addressed." How did we get here? Why has childhood TB been so neglected? Well, there's many reasons. First, childhood tuberculosis is a fundamentally different disease from adult tuberculosis. Most children who develop disease do so rapidly, within weeks or a few months of acquiring the infection, so time is absolutely critical. Childhood TB is often not difficult to diagnose clinically. when chest x-ray is available and the child can be linked to a recently diagnosed case of contagious tuberculosis. That's the key. This link is most often within the family, and just a few questions about ill family members can usually show that an ill child is at risk for having tuberculosis. However, this link requires an integrated and functional healthcare system that is lacking in many high burden areas. Children with tuberculosis have far fewer bacteria than adults, and as a result, detecting the germ using a microscope or a culture or expert is difficult, positive at best 30% of the time, making tuberculosis in children difficult to confirm microbiologically. Not to diagnose clinically, to confirm microbiologically. Several decades ago, it was decided to make microbiologic confirmation the main basis for tuberculosis case reporting for all ages. Unfortunately, doing this ensured the exclusion of children from tuberculosis reporting. I'm going to say that again. It ensured the exclusion of children from tuberculosis reporting, showing how important it is that vulnerable groups have a seat at the table when policy is being made. Second, children with tuberculosis are rarely contagious, a dead end in terms of transmission. As a result, overburdened and under-resourced tuberculosis programs have decided either actively or passively that children are less important than adults to address the overall burden of disease. Third, until recently, the child health and survival communities did not consider tuberculosis a priority item because there were no accurate estimates of morbidity and mortality to justify their inclusion. Therefore, childhood tuberculosis has been a concealed major contributor to child mortality. As a result, there was virtually no communication between tuberculosis and child health programs, and childhood TB fell into the chasm between these two efforts. However, the recent estimates put tuberculosis squarely among the major causes of childhood morbidity and mortality in the world, and the child health community is starting to respond. Fourth, there was a perception among tuberculosis policymakers that treating adults was enough. If all the contagious adult TB is eliminated, no more children would get infected. As a result, children were rarely considered or sometimes even mentioned in many tuberculosis policy statements. I was told early in my career that the way to end childhood TB was to end adult TB. Even if this were true, it would take generations to free the children of tuberculosis, with untold millions of children's lives lost. Fifth, most national and local tuberculosis programs in high-burden countries did not have policies or guidelines for the evaluation and management of children. There was a lack of expertise among pediatricians and little involvement by pediatricians in tuberculosis programs. I get to say that because I'm a pediatrician. Finally, while the BCG vaccines prevent many cases of severe childhood tuberculosis, they are not effective enough to prevent many more, and other measures are needed. BCG should be given at birth, not at 6 weeks of age, as is done in many locales, but that is not enough to protect children. Most children are infected by people they are close to, people they love, especially in the home. Contact tracing is the evaluation of people who share the air with a person with contagious tuberculosis, so they can be treated to prevent them from developing the disease. This activity, contact tracing, is extremely effective and inexpensive and has been recommended for decades by the Union and WHO and other organizations, yet has never been performed in most high-burden countries. This represents almost a completely lost opportunity to prevent a large proportion of childhood TB cases. However, despite all this, I believe that the tide has turned, and I am the most optimistic I have been in my 35 years of being a childhood tuberculosis physician. In his 2000 book, The Tipping Point, Malcolm Gladwell described three basic elements of social epidemics that lead to fundamental change, the tipping point. The first element is how trends are often driven by a handful of exceptional people. As stated by the famous anthropologist Margaret Mead, never doubt that a small group of thoughtful, committed citizens can change the world. Indeed, it is the only thing that ever has. For me, this all started in 2011 when the European Center for Disease Prevention and Control organized in Stockholm a meeting of international childhood tuberculosis experts, the first such meeting in several decades. The participants created a call to action for childhood TB with a set of principles that provided the framework for the advancement of the field. This meeting was a catalyst for international cooperation in research and clinical care in childhood TB, and it cemented the collaboration of a small but incredibly talented and dedicated group of childhood tuberculosis investigators and clinicians, leading to important advances in prevention, diagnosis, and treatment. The second element of the tipping point is determining how to make a contagious, and those are his words, contagious message memorable. This element includes both the technical aspects of improving childhood tuberculosis care, but also the messaging and branding of those efforts. Messaging and branding, something we need to greatly improve across the TB spectrum. The union has been very active in this regard, as has the childhood tuberculosis subgroup of the Stop TB Partnership. But this is an area where much more needs to be done. The third element of the tipping point is the central importance of the environment in changing behaviors. All public health is local, and each nation and community needs to determine what it needs to do to address childhood tuberculosis. This means we need to make fundamental changes in how we approach the disease and its prevention. It can no longer be seen as the purview only of tuberculosis programs, but must be integrated into other programs that serve children at risk for tuberculosis, especially ill child programs, maternal and child health programs, malnutrition programs, and HIV care programs. Over the past 6 years, there's been lots of good news and much progress. Through the World Health Organization and several others, a series of evidence-based guidelines have been developed to help clinicians better manage aspects of childhood tuberculosis. As a result, many high-burden countries have updated their tuberculosis policies and guidelines to include the needs and management of children. Some high-burden countries are starting to do contact tracing for newly diagnosed cases and determining the best methods for evaluating and treating the child contacts to prevent disease both now and in the future. In India, Pakistan, and Bangladesh, among others, programs of door-to-door contact tracing and treatment are being carried out in particularly high-burden neighborhoods. In 2013, the Union, WHO, Stop TB Partnership, UNICEF, and several other organizations published the Roadmap for Childhood Tuberculosis, a document that presents 10 fundamental principles and approaches for ending childhood tuberculosis. As a result, several organizations that are intimately involved in child health and survival, such as UNICEF, are now devoting time and resources to childhood tuberculosis. Through the efforts of organizations like the TB Alliance, USAID, and UNITAID, new child-friendly drug formulations have been developed and deployed in over 60 countries, making treatment of childhood tuberculosis easier. And there has emerged a whole new generation of incredibly bright and talented young researchers, clinicians, and policy experts who have centered their careers on childhood tuberculosis. 1 million annual cases, 210,000 annual deaths, tens to hundreds of million infected children at risk of developing disease. So are we really at the tipping point for the elimination of childhood tuberculosis? I think we are, although it will take great effort and fundamental changes in how the disease is approached, particularly in high-burden settings. It will take a paradigm shift to include children in all aspects of TB elimination and for children to put as much emphasis on prevention of tuberculosis as there should be on treating the disease once it occurs. We have to adequately address childhood tuberculosis, both disease and infection, treatment and prevention, if we are to bend the curve in the WHO-NTB effort to eliminate the disease. However, while NTB has emphasized patient-centered care, for children, this is not enough, not nearly enough. For them, we need family-centered care, the consideration of the needs in the entire family when an adult is diagnosed with tuberculosis. Most importantly, the tipping point will require the political will within the tuberculosis and child health communities and governments to devote the resources and energy that will be required if we are to reach our goal of tuberculosis elimination. Political will means money. We need better funding and integration of healthcare systems for effective and sustainable tuberculosis service delivery to children and adolescents. We need money for applied childhood TB-specific research, which has been sorely lacking and absent from many foundation portfolios. We need government officials, foundations, and other healthcare leaders to make sure that the needs of children are included in TB program budgets, global fund applications, and all research portfolios. In 2004, my friend and colleague Peter Donald stated, "The time has come for the hidden epidemic of childhood tuberculosis to emerge from the shadow of adult tuberculosis and be seen as a neglected child health problem of considerable proportions in precisely those communities that do not have the resources to deal with it adequately." These words remain true in 2017, but we now have more means to do something about it. The question is, do we have the will? Children have the same right as adults to benefit from tuberculosis care and research. And I'm going to say that one more time. Children have the same right as adults to benefit from tuberculosis care and research. It's time we put these words into action, and the elimination of tuberculosis depends on it. Thank you.
May I ask that we put our hands together again to thank Dr. Stark for what a truly inspiring talk. We have neglected pediatric TB for too long, and it's time to take action, and I hope we will do that. May I now introduce us to the stage, Dr. Antonio Cruzes, who is the minister from the state of Jalisco, who is here today representing the governor of the state of Jalisco, Jose Aristoteles Sandoval Daz. Some people do great things, and Governor Sandoval has implemented innovative policies in key social sectors, including health, and those are the kind of things we want to hear, because if you do things in the social sector, you are fighting TB. We are told that as a result of that, Jalisco is the fastest growing state economy in Mexico that has achieved the highest social advancements in the country. And therefore, I think it is really worthwhile to listen to Dr. Antonio Cruzes. Please welcome Dr. Antonio.
Muy buenas tardes, ya prácticamente noches. De manera muy particular, sé que están la mayoría de ustedes con los traductores, y por estar aquí en Jalisco voy a dar la bienvenida en español. no en inglés, pero bueno. Primero que nada, welcome to Jalisco. Here is the most biggest state, one of them, in Mexico. It's the capital of the innovation, but you receive a welcome from my government, Jorge Arizotes de Sandoval. Y bueno, primero que nada, quiero comentarles que Jalisco se congratula con recibir a toda la comunidad mundial, más de 100 países, en este congreso que organiza la Unión y que hoy celebra el número 48 aquí en el estado de Jalisco. De verdad que nos sentimos muy agradecidos. Muchísimas gracias, doctor Pablo Curi, subsecretario de Salud a nivel nacional, por haber elegido a Guadalajara, a Jalisco, como la sede de esta gran congreso en contra de las enfermedades pulmonares y la tuberculosis. Muchísimas gracias, doctor Pablo, y reciba y envíele de parte del señor gobernador un saludo al secretario de Salud, José Narro. Y de igual forma, comentar que en Jalisco una de las agendas principales que tenemos en cuestión de salud es el tema de la calidad del aire. Esto va de la mano con el tema que impera en este congreso, como son las enfermedades pulmonares. Estamos conscientes que en base a la calidad de aire que tengan las diferentes ciudades, es la calidad de vida que se tiene en las personas. Y en ese mismo sentido y con la misma visión que se tiene en las diferentes ciudades alrededor del mundo, hoy lo está haciendo Jalisco. Hoy Jalisco tiene una agenda verde que va encaminada a poder combatir ese tipo de patologías que se tienen en relación con la calidad del aire. Es de reconocer y está de más comentar la base estadística que existe a nivel México, a nivel estado, pero sabemos que la tuberculosis por sí mismo es una patología que ha llegado y que ha permanecido a través de los siglos durante mucho tiempo. Hoy, con enfermedades asociadas como el tipo del HIV, se ha agudizado. Sabemos que la Organización Mundial de la Salud tiene la meta para el 2035 el poder eliminar esta enfermedad, que hoy tenemos todos los instrumentos tecnológicos, antibióticos, todos los elementos diagnósticos para hacer un diagnóstico temprano. Y en eso es que nos hemos empeñado y nos hemos alineado a las políticas públicas nacionales del Estado mexicano. Hoy, el que durante mucho tiempo ha llevado las políticas públicas y que a final, posterior a un servidor, explicará de manera más abierta toda esta trayectoria, es el doctor Pablo Curi, a la cual hoy Jalisco se suma a esas ideologías, se suma a esas tendencias en cuestión de prevención para enfermedades pulmonares. Por eso también Jalisco ha hecho una política importante en cuestión de la lucha contra el tabaco. Bien lo decía el presidente de Uruguay, ellos también han hecho políticas muy importantes. Hoy aquí en Jalisco han endurecido y hemos endurecido tanto las sanciones como la vigilancia, tanto a través de la COFEPRIS como de la COPRISGAL, que son órganos reguladores aquí en el estado, para poder y tener espacios libres de humo. Sabemos que existe de más de 7 millones de muertes relacionadas a enfermedades pulmonares, 1 millón están relacionadas a gente que no son fumadoras y que están en contacto con el tema de los fumadores. Por eso hoy estamos en esta lucha y estamos caminando y estamos de la mano con las políticas nacionales y mundiales, que ustedes son quien las marcan, ustedes son quien determinan el rumbo de la salud pública mundial. Por eso no me queda más que darles la bienvenida aquí en Jalisco. Jalisco no es nada más la tierra del mariachi, no es nada más la tierra del tequila, que por cierto hay muy buen tequila aquí en Jalisco. Ojalá puedan degustar un buen tequila. Jalisco es la capital de la innovación. Jalisco es la capital de buscar cómo hacer mejores prácticas en todos los rubros tecnológicos, ambientales, médicos, sociales. Hoy, Hoy toca la parte de sumarnos a esa ideología de la unión y de cada uno de ustedes que están aquí buscando que a través de este congreso busquemos las nuevas prácticas que nos lleven a poder eliminar las enfermedades relacionadas a la tuberculosis en el 2035 y a mejorar todas las tendencias gubernamentales en relación a la calidad del aire para que esta minimice todas las enfermedades relacionadas a tipo fibrosis, como ya lo mencionaron, EPOC, tuberculosis, vaya, neumoconiosis, todo tipo de patologías. Y entonces reciban un saludo de parte del señor gobernador. I want to tell you for the last time, welcome to Jalisco and enjoy the Congress.
Thank you so much, Dr. Cruz. As you all know, Mexico suffered a major tragic event recently, and I think we should all remember the people of Mexico as they try to rebuild from that tragic event that happened a few weeks ago. It is for that reason that the Minister for Health of Mexico, Dr. Jose Naro Robles, is unable to be with us today because he's engaged with activities related to rebuilding and recovering from the devastating earthquake that this country suffered. However, the minister is ably represented by Dr. Pablo Curi Morales, who is the Undersecretary of Disease Prevention and Health Policy in the Mexican Ministry of Health. And now, may I welcome Dr. Pablo Curi Morales to speak to you and invite you officially into open the conference officially. Thank you.
Muy buenas noches tengan todos ustedes. Dr. Chacaya, presidente de la Unión, Dr. Castro, director ejecutivo, querida Guerri, Doctor Antonio Cruces, reciban todos los distinguidos miembros que han antecedido mi palabra, un reclamo porque ya me dejaron sin qué decir. Ya dijeron todo lo que yo quería decir y me cuesta mucho trabajo articular algunas ideas que no hayan sido tocadas ya por quienes me antecedieron. Es muy difícil ser el del final porque además todo el auditorio seguramente ya está cansado y lo que dicen lo han de estar pensando, ya apúrate, porque ya nos queremos ir a tomar unos tequilas. Pero creo que amerita esta conferencia algunas reflexiones. México fue, como ustedes saben, recientemente en nuestro territorio el epicentro de dos grandes sismos. Uno, el 7 de septiembre, de 8.2 grados Richter, el más grande que se ha registrado en territorio nacional en la historia. Y otro el 19 de septiembre, 32 años después, justo 32 años después del gran sismo que devastó la Ciudad de México en 1985. Este de 7.1 grados Richter. Y hoy, creo que nos está gustando esto de ser el epicentro, somos el epicentro de la salud respiratoria del mundo. Con esta conferencia mundial, con esta 48ª conferencia de la Unión. Y lo señalo porque se van a deliberar acá o se van a tocar temas muy relevantes para la salud global. Temas que a veces en la agenda se nos olvidan porque ¿quién no reconoce el problema que representa la obesidad, la diabetes y otras enfermedades crónicas o los accidentes o el VIH? Pero no debemos de olvidar de la agenda la tuberculosis y otras enfermedades respiratorias. Y en México hemos tomado pasos hacia la solución de este tipo de problemas. Déjenme compartir con ustedes algunas estadísticas. En México al año tenemos 20.000 casos nuevos de tuberculosis. Pero también tenemos un éxito en el tratamiento que supera el 86% de estos casos. Hemos invertido en 2016... más cerca de 17 millones de dólares para la lucha contra la tuberculosis. Y evidentemente están orientados no solo al tratamiento, sino a algo que es muy relevante. el cambio y la modificación de los determinantes sociales de la salud. Y ligo esta idea con algo que ya dijo la doctora Gerry Eikemans. Los Objetivos de Desarrollo Sostenible 2030, 17, incluyen uno de salud. Pero les puedo asegurar, si cumplimos los otros 16, eliminar la pobreza, mejorar la educación, disminuir la inequidad de género, tener un medio ambiente saludable, lograr que el agua sea adecuada, seguramente se cumplirá el objetivo de salud. Eso es una demostración clara de que tenemos que trabajar sí en la curación, por supuesto en los tratamientos de quienes tienen estas enfermedades, pero también en la modificación de los estilos de vida y los entornos, y esto se logra a través de la prevención y la promoción de la salud. Déjenme decirles que en México hemos logrado incrementar con la compra centralizada la cobertura del tratamiento a prácticamente el 100% de los casos detectados en el país de manera gratuita. Y sí hemos hecho algo que se decía por acá, hemos centrado nuestra atención en el paciente. En la medida que hagamos eso con las políticas públicas de salud, tendremos éxito. No debemos olvidar que a quienes nos debemos es a las personas que están enfermas, pero más aún a quienes están sanos para evitar que enfermen. Uno de los grandes desafíos de la tuberculosis es el que tiene que ver con el binomio, con el VIH y la diabetes. Y en ese sentido, en esta conferencia se presentará evidencia que servirá para apuntalar el conocimiento en la toma de decisiones para luchar contra estas enfermedades que representan comorbilidades importantes para el tema de la tuberculosis. Pero no solo es la tuberculosis, son las enfermedades respiratorias en general lo que aquí se va a tratar. Y uno de los factores de riesgo más importante para el desarrollo de enfermedades respiratorias es el tabaco. Y la lucha contra el tabaco ha sido una de las políticas públicas que ya desde hace años, a través del Consejo Nacional contra las Adicciones, México ha asumido a cabalidad. Y seguiremos haciéndolo. Déjenme decirles, señoras y señores, que reitero a nombre del Gobierno de la República nuestro agradecimiento a la Unión por habernos elegido a México como nuevamente el epicentro de la salud respiratoria global. Reciban ustedes un saludo del doctor José Narro, que justo por motivos vinculados a los sucesos a los que ya hice referencia, no nos ha podido acompañar en esta noche. Y si me permiten, aquí en México tenemos la costumbre de ponernos de pie para hacer las declaratorias inaugurales. Así es que les pido si se ponen de pie para hacer la declaratoria formal. Siendo las 20:05 del día 11 de octubre de 2017, me es muy grato declarar formalmente inaugurada la 48ª Conferencia Mundial sobre Salud Pulmonar de la Unión Internacional de la Lucha contra la Tuberculosis y Enfermedades Respiratorias, deseando éxito a todos los participantes y, por supuesto, que las deliberaciones de la misma conduzcan a la mejora de la salud de la población. Muchísimas gracias y nuevamente bienvenidos a México. A heart pair we will be.
is not the same without a gun. And baby, when it's love, it is not wrong, it isn't fun. I'll get him hot, show him what I've got. I'll get him hot, show him what I've got. Can't read my, can't read my, no, he can read my poker face.
Baby, we danced to three. She looked at me.